Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents The Coalwood Way by Homer Hickam. Of all the lessons I learned when I built my rockets, the most important were not about chemistry, physics, or metallurgy, but of virtues, sins, and other true things that shape us as surely as rivers carve valleys, or rain melts mountains, or currents push apart the sea. I would learn these lessons at a time when Coalwood, the mining town where I had lived my entire life, was just beginning to fade away. Yet, as the fall of 1959 began, and the leaves on the trees in the forests that surrounded us began to explode in spectacular color, Coalwood's men still walked with a trudging grace to and from the vast, deep mine, and its women bustled in and out of the company stores and fought the coal dust that drifted into their homes. In the dark old schools, the children learned and the teachers taught, and in snowy white churches built on hillside cuts, the preachers preached, and God, who we had no doubt was also a West Virginian, was surely doing his work in heaven too. At the abandoned slack dump we called Cape Coalwood, rockets still leapt into the air, and boyish voices yet echoed between ancient, worn mountains beneath a pale and watchful sky. Coalwood endured as it always had, but change would soon touch nearly everything, and no one, not even my father, would be able to stop it. When that brittle parchment autumn turned into our deepest, whitest winter, this and many other lessons would be taught. Though they were hard and sometimes cruel things to learn, they were true. And true things, as the people of Coalwood saw fit to teach me, are always filled with a shining glory. To me, there was no better time to launch a rocket than in the fall, especially a West Virginia fall. There seemed to be a cool, dry energy in the air that filled us with a renewed sense of hope and optimism. I had always believed that our rockets were lifted as much by our dreams as by burning propellant, and as the lazy summer faded and a northerly wind swept down on us with its lively breath, anything seemed possible. It was also when the school year started, and I always felt an excitement stir within me at the thought of learning new and wonderful things. Our first rocket of the fall was AUK-22E. A serious little rocket, it began its journey with a mighty spout of flame and turmoil, and its shockwave rattled our wooden blockhouse as it climbed. I ran outside with the other boys, but no matter how much I strained my eyes, I couldn't see it. All I could see were clouds that went, as far as I knew, all the way up to heaven. The seconds ticked by. We had never lost one of our rockets, but I was beginning to wonder if maybe this one was going to be our first. If it had fallen on Rocket Mountain, buried itself in the soft, black West Virginia loam up there, maybe we had missed it. "Time, Odell," I called nervously. Odell looked at the stopwatch he'd borrowed last year from one of the coal company industrial engineers and forgotten to give it back. "I think it's still flying." "Then where is it?" I demanded. "There it is," Billy yelled as he began sprinting across the slack. I still couldn't see anything, but I ran after him anyway. He easily pulled away from me with athletic grace, his muscles like small coiled springs, his shoes sending up little puffs of black grit as he ran. How that boy could run! Nobody could keep up with Billy Rose when he had his sharp eyes locked on a rocket. I, on the other hand, tended to be a pretty slow runner. I think it was because I was so nearsighted. I was always afraid I was going to run into something. Odell trotted up alongside me, putting a hand on my elbow to straighten me out. "Time looks good," he said, and then ran on ahead, his mop of blonde hair bouncing as his short legs churned. He held a stopwatch in front of him, his finger poised to click it off the moment our rocket hit the slack. Roy Lee caught up with me next. He was in his dugout clothes, a tight pair of draped and pegged black pants, brown loafers, a pink shirt with black piping, and hair thoroughly lacquered down into a swept-back DA. He had a date for the Saturday night dance at the teen hangout in War and was headed that way right after the launch. "I never can see the blamed things," he griped as he ran by me. Roy Lee's long legs soon had him beside Odell, but Billy was still far ahead. Behind me, I could hear Sherman's uneven gait, his left leg slung in an arc at each step, his built-up shoe scuffing the slack. Polio had given his leg a twist and turned it thin as a sapling. I slowed to let him catch up and run alongside me. Odell said the time looks good. Sherman broke into a grin at my report. Maybe it's going to be a great rocket. A great rocket was what Quentin, the brains of our outfit, called the rockets that did exactly what we designed them to do. I sincerely hoped Sherman was right. AUK-22E used an untried propellant. With rockets, any time you change one thing, a lot of other things change too, and it was hard to predict what they all might be. In that, I guess they were a bit like me and the rest of the boys. Even though we were all seniors in high school and thought of ourselves as being grown up, the truth was we had a way to go. I was 16, they were 17, and every day it seemed we grew a little, usually in some unpredictable way. Quentin was downrange so that he could measure the altitude of our rocket using trigonometry. To do it, he had to see the rocket at peak altitude and aim at it with a device he had built out of a broomstick, a nail, a wooden ruler, and a plastic protractor. He called his invention a theodolite. But clouds had defeated him today, the rocket disappearing through the heavy layer that hung overhead. We would have to depend on Odell's stopwatch. "Whoa, stop!" Billy cried as we ran up to him. He had his arms outstretched to hold us back. I could hear the rocket whistling as it came in, and then, 100 yards ahead, there was a big metallic report and a plume of slack. The AUK had struck nose first. 31 seconds, Odell reported as we reached the rocket. I did a quick mental calculation. I had designed AUK-22E to reach an altitude of 6,000 feet. It had reached, according to the formula we used, less than 4,000 feet. That was a disappointment. The Big Creek Missile Agency, or BCMA as we like to call it, had been in business for nearly 2 years, ever since the sight of the Russian Sputnik flying through the starry sky over Coalwood had first inspired us to join the space race. We started off slow, our rockets mostly blown up, but after a while we had gotten the hang of it. We had already sent rockets higher than a mile using our old rocket candy propellant. The new propellant we were using should have easily gotten us past the mile mark. Something had gone seriously wrong with this little rocket, and I itched to find out what it was. The smoking AUK was too hot to touch, so I gave it a quick eyeball once over. The casement, which is what we call the body of the rocket, was made from a 3-foot-long, 1.25-inch diameter length of seamless steel tubing. The wooden nose cone that had capped it had been reduced to splinters. One of the 4 fins welded to the casement had broken off. The machinists in the coal company machine shop would be interested in the damage. They had become dedicated rocket builders, sneaking in the work between jobs sent down by the mine. My father, the mine superintendent, had tried for months to stop them but had finally given up. "Mill," Dad had said to the supervisor, "they're your problem. Just remind your boys who pays their wages." The machinists heard Dad's reminder, but it didn't make much of an impression on him. Building rockets, after all, was a lot more fun than working on mine equipment. I wanted most of all to look inside the nozzle, the working end of the rocket. Our new propellant, which we called Zinco-Shine, consisted of zinc dust, sulfur, and the purest alcohol John I. Blevins could produce from his still up Snake Root Hollow. The nozzle and the propellant were the keys to our success. Unless both worked according to our designs, our rockets might fly, but they were not going to be great. While we waited for the AUK to cool, Quentin decided it would be a good opportunity to give us one of his professorial lectures. "Gentlemen, it is time we adopt a new approach to our work," he said, his index finger held aloft. "To date, we have accomplished prodigious results with our rockets. Yet, I perceive a certain tendency among some of you." At this, he sneaked a look at Roy Lee. "To see our work as, dare I say it, fun. This is not fun, gentlemen. We are about important work here. Therefore, henceforth, I challenge all of us to be absolutely, completely, and utterly rigorous." The other boys looked at him with slack jaws. He lost me too, but I was not going to let Quentin get away with much. "Define rigorous." Quentin rolled his eyes, as he always did when he was disgusted with my ignorance. "To be rigorous in our work, Sonny, means it is absolutely necessary that we have a thoroughly scientific approach to everything we do. And, of course, it also means that we must do everything quickly, without delay, lest opportunity slip between our fingers. I don't know how we can work any faster, I told him, especially since I'm doing all the drawings and seeing to the machine shop work. I can't spend all my time building rockets. I'm trying to make all A's this semester, and I've got band practice, too. I'm the head drummer, you know. Quentin looked down his long nose at me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.